We learned a bunch of stuff that is so useful, we just have to share it with you guys. A bit of pretty stuff, a bit of coding stuff, and a little public safety warning. And if you are disappointed, we have a money-back guarantee on all of our videos. I'm pretty sure you already know of timers. But in many cases you don't even need a timer now, because there is a scene tree timer you can use. Just write getTree create timer. And this call does not create a node. It's in fact a special class called SceneTreeTimer that is automatically freed after it timed out. It is usually used with a yield to wait for the timeout. But there is one thing to keep in mind. There is an optional argument I have never seen mentioned, and it caused a bug for us. It defines if the timer should stop or keep running when the game is paused. So when you use a SceneTreeTimer, by default, it does not pause. If you want that, pass an additional false.
On this channel, we have a thing for destroying sprites. We can make a destruction effect like this very, very easily. Just take a particle system and give it the same texture as the sprite. When we now read it as an animation by adding a canvas item material, it gets cut into pieces for the individual animation frames. Set the animation speed to 0, but random the offset, which is the starting animation frame, and we get lots of different pieces. We can adjust some parameters, create an animation, and stuff breaks!
And then there's this little but very useful thing we just missed for far too long. You can open a scene by double clicking the instance. Or you click this film flap icon on the scene tree. Thank you, Selena.
By the way, if you find these videos generally helpful, please drop a like. It helps us judge if you guys still like the series, and it makes more people see it. If you don't, I have to call your mom and tell her. Or I call a whole group, because I can do that. With getTree call group, and it is really, really useful. Whenever you have a bunch of nodes in a group and you want to call a method on all of them, you can do this. Usually this is done deferred, but you can also use call group flags and additionally pass the flag group call realtime if you need it instantly. Thanks Pete275 for the trick.
With Godot 4 there will be per instance uniforms for shaders. And this is amazing. I was looking for something similar in Godot 3 and finally found it. You can read a sprite's modulate from shader. Simply use modulate. From this point onwards it is not automatically multiplied with the color anymore. But you can use it for your own stuff. Imagine you have a dissolve shader. You have this material applied to many sprites, but they all dissolve at once, which is bad. Of course you can make the materials unique, but it's a butt pain and the sprites cannot be batched anymore. You can also read the channels of modulate as your variable and modulate them using the same material. Much faster to do and much more performant. Of course you can use this trick for crazier optimizations than this. Have fun!
Small little extra here. With a tween, you can interpolate the different channels of a modulate individually. When you write modulate colon A, for example. This is especially useful when you use these channels as shader parameters. Until last week, I always interpolated the whole color. Like an animal!
There's a really hidden way to use signals. Truly shocking, some might say. Like Alfonso, who brought us this tip. You have additional parameters when connecting them. First, you can add binds as an array. They will be unpacked and passed as arguments to the called method. This can come in handy when you want to connect the same method in multiple ways. There are also flags you can pass, defining if the signal should be called deferred or if it should be saved when the object is serialized. Also, when it should be deleted. One of the most useful ones is connect one shot, where the signal is disconnected after it is fired once. This makes a cool alternative to yield. Yields can be problematic, because you cannot cancel them once they are started. And then the waiting object might get deleted and everything gets strange.
We now come to some things that might be illegal in some parts of the world, but don't tell anybody. Reflection is powerful, but it can produce terrible things. You can call getPropertyList on an object and it will return an array of dictionaries, giving you the property name and type. Combine that with set and you can take an object and set all numbers to 0, etc. For data classes like these, you can do some stuff in very few lines of code, if you really want to. I'm sure there are other uses, maybe you have some ideas.
You probably know that you can add static type hints when you declare a variable, in method signatures and in the return type. A nice thing is that you can go to editor settings, text editor, completion, add type hints, and it will add type hints when you connect a signal or create a script. And there are more great things in the same menu. You see these delays here. Some of them might be a bit long. The idle pass delay is your syntax check. If you reduce it, you get faster responses. Put it too low and you might get some errors while writing though. And maybe you want to reduce the auto-completion delay as well. Thanks Nathan for both of these, you really make our Discord a better place.
And just in case you missed it like I did, Godot writes logs, even in production builds. You can find them in user logs, godot.log. To toggle that option or change the path, go to project settings, logging, file logging. That's it for now, stay tuned for the next one, and go share your tricks in the comments.